We are so glad to have a very near, dear, close friend of ours joining us today. He currently resides upon our board of Jimmy Swaggart Bible College, and he's been a good friend for the last 20-some-odd years. And we are thrilled every year to have this man come because he blesses us each and every single time he ministers. And I want you to stand, Family Worship Center, and let's give a very warm Louisiana welcome to Evangelist Jason Stidham, all the way from Fort Worth, Texas.
God bless you. God bless you. You may be seated. I texted Gabriel last night and said, the LSU Tigers just made my job much, much harder tomorrow morning. I bring condolences from the 5-0 Texas Longhorns. For the first time since 2009, I have to say something. Next week, we play our dreaded rivals, the Oklahoma Sooners. It is called the Red River Rivalry. When I grew up, we called it the Red River Shootout. Then it became politically incorrect to call it a shootout. Can I just stop here and say people are stupid? If you think calling a football game a shootout encourages gun violence, you are stupid. Oklahoma is our arch rival. What I am hoping is that President Donald J. Trump will be reelected and will build a wall between Texas and Oklahoma, and we're going to make Oklahoma pay for it. All of my Oklahoma friends, I love you. 364 days out of the year. What a privilege and honor it is to be back in one of America's great Pentecostal churches. Family Worship Center, you are touching the world for the cause of Christ. And it is our honor every time that the Swaggart family expresses their confidence and extends another invitation for us to grace this pulpit. Let me take just a few moments and recognize, number one, you have some of the finest singers and musicians in all of the world. You have some of the greatest preachers on this platform in all of the world. So appreciative of my friendship and relationship with Pastor Gabe. This year we will be conducting again. This is our 10th anniversary for the Acts 6-4 conference. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of Pentecostal preachers from the Assemblies of God, the Church of God, Church of God in Christ, the Pentecostal Holiness, the independent Pentecostals, the list goes on and on, will be joining us. And I am happy to announce that on the final night, Evangelist Donnie Swaggart is going to be preaching the Acts 6-4 conference for us in January. We are highly anticipatory of his ministry. And then let me say that just yesterday I received a message via social media. It was from the district superintendent of the Illinois District of the Assemblies of God. And he asked that I would express his thanks and appreciation to Brother and Sister Swaggart. He said, in 1974, our family came into the Pentecostal experience because of their ministry at the Illinois Assembly of God District Camp. And I want to say that is just one of multiplied millions. And would you join me this morning and express appreciation to this man and woman of God who have touched the world not only with the gospel but with the message of Pentecost? We love you. We appreciate you. You are dynamic in every way. Praise the Lord. Thank you. The Bible admonishes us not to think too highly of ourselves. Y'all say amen. Amen. Last time I was here, I preached Sunday morning, Sunday night. At the conclusion of the Sunday night sermon, there were a number of people, as is often the case, gathered here beside the platform awaiting me. They wanted to shake my hand. They wanted to give some very gracious comments concerning the ministry. Sometimes they want a photograph. Sometimes they want a signature in their Bible. And I stepped off to the side of the platform following the evening service, was greeting those people. There was one gentleman, probably 75, 76 years of age. He'd waited very patiently while I worked through 8 or 9, 10 people. He was the last one in the line. I'm talking about not thinking too highly of yourself. And I extended my hand toward him to shake his hand, thinking that he wanted to talk to me. He slapped his cell phone in my hand and said, "Hey, bud, will you take my picture with the Swaggerts, please?" So if you came to hear and see a Swaggert today, I apologize to you. They will be readily available again next Sunday. The 25th Psalm in your Bible, please. Psalm 25. Then we'll be moving to the New Testament, Romans chapter 1. Psalms, or the Psalm, the 25th Psalm, verses 1 and 2. "To you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in you. May I not be ashamed." Take note. The prayer of David, "May I not be ashamed. May my enemies not triumph over me." Paul's writing to the church at Rome, Romans chapter 1, verse 16, a very familiar passage of Scripture. As I was seeking the Lord this week for his direction, there are many things that I could preach. I want to preach the thing for this particular moment in time. I had just delivered all of my text and information to the television department here at the ministry. I was in my office. The Sun Life Broadcasting Network was on. A sermon began to play from 2014 where Pastor Mike Musserall read this exact text and gave me the confirmation and the confidence that I was asking for. Paul said, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. For it is the power for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek." Now I want to preach for a few moments on this subject, not ashamed. I came today to pray something so that we might then say something. I said, I came today to pray something. Oh God, may I not be ashamed. So that we can then leave this place and say something. I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God. Would you lift your hands with me all across this auditorium and let's pray the prayer of David. Oh God, would you come and enable us today? Help us, Lord, to minister your word. Help us, Holy Spirit, now. Help us so that we may not be ashamed. We are living in such a pressured and prophetic moment in time. Help us to leave this place empowered by your word and your spirit, so that we can make the same proclamation as the Apostle Paul, that we are not ashamed of the gospel. We'll ask it all in Christ's name, and everyone said, amen. I suppose one would have to be deaf, dumb, and blind not to realize the attack that the Christian faith is currently under. We are being targeted from every sector of society. I want you to hear me. They are not attempting to merely censor us. Their goal is to totally and completely silence us. We have borne in recent months under this onslaught and attack, I believe inspired by the spirit of the Antichrist that John said is currently operating in this world. A number of labels I read from my notation in my introduction because the subject matter is very weighty and very delicate, and I want to choose my words carefully. Recent attempts by the left to label, to make liable, and to limit both Christians and the propagation of the gospel are their attempts to silence us. Understand what I just said. They intend to totally silence Christians and their representation of the gospel. We have been called numerous things. We have been called racists. What's interesting to me about this particular label that is hurled against us is it really does not matter what ethnicity one is. Once they recognize you are a follower of Jesus, then you must be a racist. Red, yellow, black, brown, or white, if you serve Jesus, you must be racist. We have been called prejudiced. We have been called biased. We have been called misogynistic, xenophobic, homophobic. We have been called recently threats to democracy. Here's a label that you have heard used much of late. We have been called domestic terrorists and Christian nationalists. Now let me stop in my introduction and say that that particular term, Christian nationalist, needs to be fleshed out. It needs to be defined. Recognize with me this morning that we're living in an hour where words are used to mean multiple things. And I have come to a point in my ministry where I oftentimes stop in conversation with others and ask them, please define for me what you mean when you say thus and such. And I have been shocked at some of the definitions that people have used because they are far and away from the Webster's definition of the terminology that they are using. What is a Christian nationalist? Unfortunately, those that are using this particular label against us are making a false association. Give me the first picture, if you would, please. They want you to believe that a Christian nationalist is a lawbreaker. They want you to believe that we are, as I said a moment ago, threats to democracy, that we are those who were associated with the overrun of the Capitol, that infamous January the 6th. And then they draw the link, the illogical link. Give me the second picture, if you would, please. This is my good friend, former Arkansas Senator Jason Rapert. He's not been out of office for long. Notice the title of this particular article. I am honored to serve as a faith advisor on his board of the National Association of Christian Lawmakers that now has a Christian representative in every state of this nation. But notice the title of this article. How a proud, quote, unquote, Christian nationalist, preacher and ex-legislator's organization pushes biblical bills. This man is blood washed, born again. This man is spirit filled, tongue talker. This man is one of the original, he is one of the originators of the right to life bills, the heartbeat bills that were passed before Roe and Wade was overturned. That if Roe and Wade were to be overturned, immediately these heartbeat bills would stop abortions. This man is a proponent of putting the Ten Commandments in the great Razorback state. And they call him a Christian nationalist. So let's just stop here and say, if by using the term Christian nationalist, you mean that I am a dedicated disciple of the Lord Jesus, and I am a proud, patriotic citizen of the United States, sign me up. I are one. I said, sign me up. I are one. If by Christian nationalist you mean, give me that next photograph, please, that I still stand and pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all, sign me up because I guess I am one. Unashamedly. If by Christian nationalist you mean that I still enjoy singing songs like God Bless America, land that I love, stand beside her and guide her through the night with a light from above, over the mountains and the prairies and the oceans white with foam, God bless America, our home, sweet home. I am not ashamed to be a follower of Jesus Christ and a proud patriot of the United States of America. Not ashamed. I said not ashamed. Let me stop here and say that there are few voices in the ministry. There are others, but there are few that rightly represent the message shared in my introduction than Evangelist Donnie Swaggart. And I thank him for standing up for these great truths and being a bold voice in this prophetic hour and time. Very grateful, very grateful. We bear all manners of labels. They call us antiquated. They call us archaic. They say that we are a stumbling block to the progression of modern society. If what we are seeing take place in this country is called progression, God help us all. My former general superintendent of the Assemblies of God, the next photo, if you would please, Dr. George O. Wood, talked with me on many occasions about the chaos that was occurring in our culture. Dr. Wood said, "Jason, if I can define you, I can then confine you. If I can define you, I can then confine you." Understand what the powers that be are attempting to do. They are attempting to define us so that they might then confine us. They are making a caricature of Christianity. How many of you know what a caricature is? Some years ago, we took our children to the city of San Antonio. We went to visit SeaWorld. Let me just stop here and say that one day at SeaWorld must be very similar to what 7 years of tribulation will be like in the prophetic future. I don't like SeaWorld. There in that park, they had artists positioned through the park. They were caricature artists. And what they do is you sit down, you put your son or your daughter before them, and they begin to draw a likeness of you. It will look very much like you, except the caricature artist will pick a particular feature of your face and will then grossly exaggerate that feature. I mean, you will have a nose that's a half a mile long, ears like those of an elephant, teeth like those of a crocodile. It's you, grossly exaggerated in one particular aspect or another. You know what an exaggeration is? Come on, I'm in Louisiana. All you people in here, you just had a fish fry yesterday. You went out, caught a fish like this, came home, told everybody you caught a fish like this. You said, "Well, I exaggerated." No, you lied. That's what you did. So they are misrepresenting us as Christ followers. They are portraying us, but they are grossly misrepresenting particular aspects of the Christian faith. In the 1950s, there was a very interesting study done by Solomon Ash. Give me the next photo, if you would, please. It's called the Ash Conformity Experiment. Solomon Ash was a brilliant sociologist, and he wanted to measure the effect that a majority has on a minority. So they developed a very simplistic, elementary type test. They brought in 8 people. Understand, 7 of the 8 were in essence paid actors. They knew exactly what was occurring. They knew the end of the experiment before the experiment ever began. Only the 8th person was a true volunteer who had no idea what was occurring. They presented them with a chart, such as you see here on the screens. You see Exhibit 1. It is called the standard line. And then they presented them 3 following lines and asked them, they polled the 8 people a simple question. An elementary child could answer the question: which of the following 3 lines is identical or matches the standard line? And then they had the 7 paid actors answer first. Person number 1 answered in error. Person number 2 answered in error. Person number 3 answered in error. Person number 4 answered in error. They would all either pick a line that was shorter, obviously, or a line that was longer, obviously. And then all eyes and ears turned toward person number 8. They wanted to see, what will a person do when they are in the minority? And do you realize that Ash's study showed that 35% of the time, the 8th person answered in error? They were then asked following the experiment, why did you answer in error? You know that that line that you chose is shorter than the standard. You know the line you chose is longer than the standard. Why would you answer wrong? It's not that you didn't know. You knew the right answer. And those people, without fail, responded and said, we just didn't want to rock the boat. We didn't want to stand out. We didn't want to go against the flow. Ladies and gentlemen, understand what's happening. I said, understand what's happening. You and I are facing these excess pressures. They are attempting to drive us into a position of silence. They are attempting to cause us to be ashamed of Christ and our testimony. Let me give you 2 definitions concerning the word ashamed from the Webster's Dictionary. Number 1 is the most common understanding of the word ashamed. It means feeling shame, guilt, or disgrace. Number 2, this is the definition I want to draw your attention to for this sermon. It means to become reluctant or unwilling to do something because of shame or embarrassment. How can you and I leave this place not ashamed? 4 different things I want to preach to you quickly. Number 1, be not ashamed of the Savior. I said, be not ashamed of the Savior. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10 and verse 11, for the Scripture says, whoever believes in Him will not be ashamed. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Can I stand here on International Christian Television before this great body of believers and say that we must not be ashamed of Jesus Christ? I am not ashamed of Jesus. I am not ashamed of the eternally existent second member of the triune Godhead. I said, I am not ashamed that somewhere in the eternal past, in the mind of God, it was decided that the Lamb of God would be slain for the sins of the world. And He, being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but took upon Himself the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. I am not ashamed to say that I believe the Savior is virgin born. You see, science says that is madness. Science says that is illogical. Science says, you Christians, that's the problem. Such is an impossibility. But I say to science, with our God, all things are possible. Hallelujah. I'm not ashamed to say that I believe He's virgin born. I'm not ashamed that He was born of all places in a manger. He should have been born in a palace. He should have been born in a royal court. But he was born in a manger. I'm not ashamed that he was reared and raised in an off-the-map, obscure place. So much so that it was asked, can anything good come out of Faraday? Hallelujah. Can anything good come out of Baton Rouge? Can anything good come out of Nazareth? Can I tell you, ladies and gentlemen, with God, good things can come out of anywhere, anytime, and any place. Not ashamed of Jesus Christ. Not ashamed of Jesus Christ. Not ashamed that he was reared and raised a carpenter's son. The trade of carpentry would be what he would learn. Not ashamed to say, I believe he lived a sinless life. Not one fault, not one failure, not one mishap, not one mess up for 33 and a half years. Not ashamed to say that I believe he healed the sick. I said, I'm not ashamed to say, for all my cessationist friends, I'm sorry, but we are not ashamed to say that Jesus is the healer of the diseases of mankind. He opened blinded eyes. He unstopped deaf ears. He caused lame men to walk, dumb men to talk. He cleansed the leper. I'm not ashamed to say I believe he is the healer. Not ashamed to say, I believe he multiplied loaves and fish and fed thousands. I believe that his words were life. I'm not ashamed of his own proclamations that no man comes to the Father but by me. I'm not ashamed to say that there is no other name under heaven whereby men must be saved. Allah will not save you. Confucius will not save you. Muhammad will not save you. But there is one who can and will save you. And of him we must not be ashamed. Hallelujah. Not ashamed to say that he gave his life as a ransom for many. He could have called for a host of angels to come and deliver him, but he allowed himself to be arrested. He allowed himself to endure a kangaroo court and a trial that was a mockery. He allowed himself to be stripped. He allowed himself to be beaten. He allowed himself to be nailed to a cross. He said, I freely lay my life down. Not ashamed. I'm not ashamed that of all places for the Son of God to die, he died between two thieves. A shameless position for most that would observe. But I'm not ashamed that a thief and sinner was on the right and a thief and sinner was on the left. Why? Because you and I have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. I thank God that his son was crucified between two sinners, came to save us from our sin. Not ashamed to say that he was taken from that cross and laid to rest in a borrowed tomb. Not even enough money to purchase his own sepulcher. And I'm not ashamed to say that I still believe that some 72 hours later, just as he said, the Spirit of the living God flooded into that tomb, took up residence in that corpse, and the stone could not hold him. He arose. He arose. Hallelujah. Christ arose. Not ashamed to say that he proved himself alive for 40 days with many infallible proofs. Not ashamed to say that he is arisen and is now seated at the right hand of God. Not ashamed to say, not only do I believe that he's the healer, but I believe just as he said, when I get to the right hand of God, I'm going to send back somebody to take my place. Not ashamed to say that we believe Jesus is the baptizer in the Holy Spirit. That he sent the comforter. And that he abides, hallelujah, he abides with me. Not ashamed. Not ashamed to say that because I believe all the aforementioned, that I also believe what His Word states, that I have become a new creation in Christ Jesus. Not ashamed to say that I believe my sins have been removed from me as far as the east is from the west. Not ashamed to say that I believe I have been washed and made as white as snow. Not ashamed to say that I believe my name has been written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. Are you not ashamed of the Savior this morning? Not only all of those things, but I'm not ashamed to say that I still believe one day He's going to vacate that seat of power, prominence, and position. I believe that He's coming back just like He said. I believe that a trumpet's going to sound so loud one day it'll wake the dead. I believe He's going to return and set His feet here on planet Earth. He's going to establish a governance of His rule and reign. There shall be no end. I'm not ashamed to say I believe Jesus is our soon coming King. Not ashamed of Jesus Christ. Not ashamed of Jesus Christ. Not ashamed of Jesus Christ. Number two, not only must we not be ashamed of the Savior, but we must not be ashamed of the Scriptures. You see, this is where many people depart. They'll be in agreement with you and I concerning Jesus. But now, wait a minute, I just don't believe everything in that Bible. You, sir, you, ma'am, are an oxymoron. With heavy emphasis on moron. Come on. You're a walking contradiction. You're confused. You cannot say that you believe in the Savior and not believe in the Scriptures. Why? Because they are synonymous one with another. They are inseparable. They are the same. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. It's impossible to believe in one and not the other. You and I must be committed to not be ashamed of the Scriptures. I'm ordained with the Assemblies of God. This church adheres to the same doctrines as the Assemblies of God. Fundamental truth number one says the Scriptures, both the Old and New Testament, are verbally inspired of God and are the revelation of God to man, the infallible, authoritative rule of faith and conduct. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15, Paul wrote to his spiritual son, "Study to show yourself approved by God, a workman who need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." Let me walk through a few hot topics, if I might, please. Give me the next photo. December the 13th, 2022. Joseph R. Biden, President of the United States, signed into law the Respect for Marriage Act. This law promotes, pushes an agenda of sexual confusion. Our country is being overrun with sexual confusion. Understand with me, ladies and gentlemen, things are occurring in this country that were once, not long ago, taboo, unspoken, never seen in the light of day. Now such things parade themselves down Main Street. You see, they have, quote, come out of the closet, end quote. Not only have they come out of the closet, but as I've preached to you already, they have every intention of putting us in the closet. But I've come to say today that we are not ashamed of the Scriptures. I've come to say that the only closet that we plan on visiting is the prayer closet that Jesus spoke about. We're going to go into that closet and we're going to pray something so that when we come out, we can say something. We are not ashamed of what Genesis says. When God created them, He created them male and He created him female. That's the way that God created us. Not ashamed. I said not ashamed of what the Scriptures teach. Not ashamed. Not ashamed. The next photo, if you would please. Now we are seeing perversion beyond description. You see, perversion knows no bottom. I said it knows no bottom. Just about the time you think it can't get any worse, it gets worse. Now we are seeing drag queens. There's nothing royal about drag. Let me just stop and say that. Drag queens. We see them being allowed access to elementary children. You see, for those of you that sit here this morning and say, well, now, evangelist, I'm never going to buy into this. I'm never going to believe this. You need to stop and understand it's not about you. They've given up on you. No. It's about your children. It's about your grandchildren. It's about your great-grandchildren. You see, what they are trying to do is indoctrinate them at a very early age, where what we now know to be abnormal, in a few years, your children will look at you, and because you believe the book, they'll say, Mama, Papa, you're strange. That's the plan. I said, that's the plan. So if they can do this without shame, if they can send this to our institutions of education and have no shame in doing so, then surely, give me the next photo. Surely we as men and women of God can send our children to school and teach them, when you get there, stand up and say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who've sinned against us. Come on, lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the honor and the power and the glory forever. We must not become ashamed of the Scriptures. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Not ashamed. Not ashamed. Not ashamed. Not ashamed. Let me talk to you about something that's very close to my heart, and I have to watch myself, because though what I'm about to say is truth, I can get the wrong spirit or attitude. Now let me stop here and preach. God didn't call you to be arrogant. He didn't call you to be antagonistic. He didn't call you to be an adversary of the sinner. But nor did he call you to be ashamed. I have to watch myself, because this touches my house. Give me the next photo, if you would, please. Not many months ago, the United States Supreme Court overturned the horrific legislation known as Roe v. Wade. It was something that had been prayed for, something that had been worked for decades. Over 6 million children's blood has been spilled because of this atrocity. Let me stop here and say, if you read the Bible, if you read the book of Genesis, if you read the story of Cain and Abel, you will recognize that innocent blood cries out to God. It demands vindication. It demands justice. I personally was somewhat shocked at the lack of response by many in the church when Roe v. Wade was overturned. Far too many of us said nothing. I had posted on social media concerning my appreciation of the overturning of this particular case, and I had one of my contemporaries, another full gospel minister, who said to me, "Let's be careful that we are not overboard in our celebration." I said to him, "Define overboard, my brother." Because you see, those opposed to the pro-life position will consider any celebration overboard. And we must not be ashamed. I said, we must not be ashamed. Give me the final photo, if you would, please. This is my 16-year-old son, Hagen Samuel, a firstborn. Born, and very shortly after his birth, we discovered that he had trisomy 21. It's Down syndrome. Most of us have two of the 21st gene. Hagen and those like him have three of the 21st gene. Raising him for 16 years, one thing that Tasha and I have learned is how really abnormal she and I are. And how normal Hagen is. And there are those who believe that my son and those like him should not have the right to life. They believe that he is a burden on this society. They believe that for his good and the good of the family and the good of the society, that his life would have been better terminated in the womb. Let me just stop here and say, and right now there are many politicians that are debating, will we support a 15-week ban for abortion? Will we support a 6-week ban for abortion? Will we support any kind of ban for abortion? Let me just stop and say, as far as we, the people of God, are concerned, our position must unashamedly align itself with the Bible, because it is the final rule of faith and conduct in our life. And the Bible says through the writings of Jeremiah that before I ever formed you in the womb or the belly of your mother, I knew you and I ordained a path for your life. We are unashamedly proponents of the pro-life position. So we must not be ashamed of the Savior. We must not be ashamed of the Scriptures. Number three, are you ready? We must not be ashamed of his sufferings. See, y'all were all with me when I talked about not being ashamed of the Savior, not being ashamed of the Scriptures. But you all left me when I said we must not be ashamed of his sufferings. What does the Bible say concerning the matter? 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse number 8. Paul writes to his spiritual son, "So do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in the sufferings of the gospel by the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not by our works, but by his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now revealed by the appearing of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who has abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, for which I was appointed a preacher, an apostle, and a teacher of the Gentiles." Notice, Paul said, "For these things I suffer, but I am not ashamed." Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Understand with me this morning that not being ashamed of the Savior and not being ashamed of the Scripture will surely cause you to suffer. You will find yourself in the minority. You will find yourself an outcast. You will find yourself a target of ridicule and false allegations and labels that do not accurately describe you. But friends, even as you suffer, align yourself with the Apostle Paul and do not be ashamed. For I know whom I have believed, and I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed to him until that day. If you're listening, if you're watching, and you say, now you're not a very good preacher because you are trying to take a verse that was personally applied to the Apostle Paul and broaden that application to the universal church. We're not all called to suffer. Let me read to you another verse from the same letter written to Timothy. 2 Timothy 3, verse 12. Paul says, yes, and all. A-double-L. And all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. It's inevitable. I said it's inevitable. You and I are going to suffer for the cause of Christ. But we must not allow said suffering to cause us shame. There's much teaching that needs to occur in the American church on the subject of suffering. Because we believe wrongly, we believe errantly, that suffering must be tied to some misbehavior. That if you're suffering, you must have done something wrong. If you're suffering, there must be some unconfessed sin. And while that is certainly true to a point, that yes, sin will cause suffering in one's life, what we also need to hear is the other side of the theological coin, that oftentimes as Christians who are committed to the Savior, who are committed to the Scriptures, we suffer, my friend, not because we have done something wrong. No, no, no. We suffer because we have done something right. We suffer because we have done something right. We must not become ashamed to suffer for the cause of Christ. Fourth and finally, not ashamed of the Savior. Not ashamed of the Scriptures. Not ashamed of his suffering. And because of these things, we will not be ashamed at his second coming. I said, we will not be found ashamed at his second coming. Luke's gospel, the 9th chapter, verse 21. Jesus strictly commanded them to tell no one of this, saying, the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. Then he said to them all, if anyone will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever will save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will save it. For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world, yet loses or forfeits his own soul? Listen, for whoever is ashamed of me, this is Jesus speaking, for whoever is ashamed of me, the Savior, and my words, the Scriptures, of him will the Son of Man be ashamed when he comes in his own glory and in the glory of his Father and the holy angels. 1 John chapter 2, verse 28, John wrote, and now, little children, remain in him so that when he appears, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him when he comes. Now, unless you're here this morning, in case you're here this morning, and you say, evangelist, this has been a nice sermon, And I'm in agreement with what you've stated. But what you don't know about me is how committed I am to Christ. What you don't know is how long I've served the Lord. What you don't know is how passionate I am in pursuit of His divinity and leading and will in my life. What you don't know, sir, evangelist, what you don't know is I could never be ashamed of Jesus. I could never be ashamed of the Scriptures. My response to you is simply this. Be careful. You sound too much like Simon Peter. I remember when Jesus was preaching one day, and he said, Peter, Satan has desired to have you, to sift you as wheat, but I have prayed for you that your faith fail not. Peter said, oh, no, Lord. This sermon was good for Bartholomew. It was good for Philip. It was good for Nathaniel. You see, some of y'all, you've been thinking this is good for those around you. No, it's good for you. I said it's good for you. He believed himself to be beyond the capacity of being shamed for the cause of Christ. But very shortly after Jesus was incarcerated, he found himself ashamed before a maiden and ashamed before those that accused him of traveling with Jesus. Friends, I've come with what I believe is a prophetic warning from the Spirit of the Lord. We are facing the powers of the Antichrist. We are facing supernatural pushback. And we're going to need the power of the Spirit to stand not ashamed in the days, the weeks, the months, if God allows the years to come. Singers and musicians, come. I want to read to you as I close. Something entitled The Fellowship of the Unashamed. This particular pose is said to have been written in 1980 by a believer in Rwanda. He was taken because of his commitment to Christ. He was given the opportunity to recant. He refused and became a martyr. They killed him. Just this week, I received a phone call from a fellow minister. His wife is in the country of Kenya. He said, my wife is in Kenya. She's ministering there. And he said, just last night, there was a pastor's wife who came and spoke and ministered. And she, because of her commitment to Christ, was tied to a post and beaten beyond recognition. This is a real deal, folks. After this believer from Rwanda became a martyr, they discovered this particular writing in his home that was dated 24 hours prior to his execution. Once again, it's entitled The Fellowship of the Unashamed. It says, I am a part of the fellowship of the unashamed. The die has been cast. I have stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense, and my future is secure. I am finished and done with low living, sight walking, small planning, smooth knees, colorless dreams, chintzy giving, and dwarfed goals. I no longer need preeminence, prosperity, position, promotions, plaudits, or popularity. I now live by presence, lean by faith, love by patience, lift by prayer, and labor by power. My pace is set. My gait is fast. My goal is heaven. My road is narrow, my way is rough, my companions few, my guide reliable, my mission clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, deterred, lured away, turned back, diluted, or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice, hesitate in the presence of adversity, negotiate at the table of the enemy, ponder at the pool of popularity, or meander in the maze of mediocrity. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ. I must go until heaven returns, give until I drop, preach until all know, and work until he comes. Hear this final sentence. And when he comes to get his own, he will have no problem recognizing me. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. Would you stand to your feet all across this house? Lift your hands and your voices. Lift your hearts toward heaven. Come on, let's begin to pray. I said, let's begin to pray the prayer of the psalmist. Come on, right now. Let's begin to pray the 25th Psalm. Let's begin to believe that the Lord will enable us. He will equip us. He will empower us. Oh God, may we not be ashamed. Come on, may we not be ashamed. Come on, pray. We're going to open the altar, but I want you to pray. Pray. May I not be ashamed on my work site. May I not be ashamed on the school campus. May I not be ashamed in my neighborhood. May I not be ashamed in the city of Baton Rouge. May I not be ashamed in the state of Louisiana. May I not be ashamed in this great country called America. I sense the power, the presence, the person of the Spirit. Now that we've prayed something, we're ready to say something. I said, now that we've prayed something, we're ready to say something. We're going to leave this place with the proclamation of Paul. I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God. If you can say that as they begin to sing, would you come? Come on, all over this house. Come to this altar right now. Come on and join me. Let's begin to say it together. Let's begin to say it together.
Of the gospel. The gospel of Jesus.
Come on, come on, come on. Let's begin to say it together.
From victory unto victory.
Come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. The body of Christ is an army. It's an army of righteousness. And everywhere we go, in the marketplace, in school, on the job, we must let others know that we are children of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Thank you, Jason, for that word.